On our programs are not necessarily those of WVON, Midway Broadcasting Corporation, or our participating sponsors.
The following is paid programming. The views are not necessarily those of this station. We are the talk of Chicago, 1690 WVON.
All right, brothers and sisters, ain't no other show like it. That's Black, Strong, Unapologetically Pro Farrakhan. We're talking about Straight Words. We're on every Tuesday from 9 until midnight on WVON 1690, the talk of Chicago. Go to our website. It is straightwords.com, straightwords.com. You can join our conversation tonight at 773-591-1690, 773-591-1690. Brother Naba'a Richard Muhammad is the editor-in-chief of the greatest newspaper on the planet for Black people and those who are looking for light, life, and power to empower their minds and their families.
Sure.
We talk about the Final Call newspaper.
Yeah.
By his side is the great former editor. His name is Brother James G. Muhammad.
Yes, sir.
And I'm Brother BJ. I'm riding in the back seat.
Yes,
you know, I'm riding with the heavyweight brothers of journalism as the National Association of Black Journalists is going on right now in the city of Chicago. And these two heavyweight brothers, of course, they've been there. The Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan has spoken to that crowd, and we're going to get into that conversation in just a minute because some controversy surrounding Donald Trump speaking there. I think it's tomorrow, right, brothers?
Yes, sir.
They're going to question him. But before we get in that conversation, we got Brother Jason wants to make some comments on Straight Words or WVON. Go right ahead, Jason.
Well, Brother Jason is actually our guest for this segment.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, this is Brother Jason Palmer, right? He's a member of NABJ. He actually worked on the convention, and he really wrote a great piece about this. Basically broke over the last few days, the NABJ, National Association of Black Journalists, annual conference, thousands of people. It was announced actually at night, I think, that they were having Donald Trump come in. And, but Jason, get on in here, man, and tell us what's going on. I ain't got to reach out. You tell us what's up.
Good evening, guys. BJ, nice to talk to you. I've not met you before. Always good to talk to Brother James and Brother Richard. And, you know, I want to say this publicly again. I'm always grateful for Brother Richard and Brother James for giving me, a young brother right out of college, the opportunity to freelance with the greatest newspaper. That was over 20 years ago. And I will never forget people who helped me as I was starting with my career. And I still try to submit some stuff to them when I can as well. But I just want to publicly thank them for that and let them know how important their mentorship was in helping to develop my writing style and just covering Chicago in general.
Yeah, and you big shot now, huh?
No, I'm not. I love my community like you brothers do, and I try to use my talent to uplift my community and inform my community, and that is why this situation that we're getting ready to discuss hurts a lot. So, I've been a journalist for 25 years in Chicago for Atlanta. I've been an NABJ member, kind of on and off. Not a big fan of the organization, but I understand the benefits of it, and I try to use the benefits of it to help other young Black journalists and myself as well. But at this particular time, I am an active paying member. Chicago is hosting the conference this year, which is a really big thing. There are over 3,700 registered participants who are coming to Chicago to be at this convention. The Chicago chapter of the NABJ, we were asked to help the national organization. Every host city, that chapter will host different events. So we volunteer for different events throughout the course of the 5 days of this year. I was one of those people who volunteered. We got our assignments, what we're going to be doing, and then last night at 9:15 p.m., all NABJ members got an email letting us know that former President Donald Trump would be attending the conference and participating in a sit-down panel with three journalists in a Q&A session. And I cannot explain to you brothers enough the shock that went through me and through the membership as a whole. You just spoke in your previous segment about the need to build businesses and get your spiritual house in order and all these things. And, you know, the NABJ convention is that for a lot of people, especially a lot of young journalists who get to network, learn new things through the sessions and panels. And for those of us who are volunteering for this event, we didn't know about this. And we learned to find out that the Chicago chapter was never informed that Donald Trump was going to be coming. So, as I was talking to Brother Richard earlier, that would be like if the Nation of Islam wanted to do something in the Baltimore area, and the national office came in and never notified the Baltimore office, hey, we'll be there, we're going to be doing this stuff, and they just came in and did it. You know, that wouldn't, it's just not a good way to do things, you know. Right. You're disconnected from your membership when you do stuff like that. And so that was the first problem, that they didn't even tell the Chicago chapter what they had done, because we would have advised them, don't do that. Don't bring him here.
Right.
Like, Chicago's the last place to bring him. The last time he came here, we saw what happened at University of Illinois.
Exactly. Right.
So this is not smart. You're going to put our memberships in, there's a safety issue here now, because where he comes, his cult members follow. And you're going to interject his cult members with black people in Chicago? Okay. Right. Okay. We're going to see it. You just know how this is going to go. But right. They went and did it anyway. And, you know, we've now come to find out a lot of stuff in these last 24 hours because the backlash has been so severe. The National Newspaper Publishers Association and Benjamin Chavis have now, they are asking the NABJ to rescind the invitation to Donald Trump. Jamel Hill has also said that. April Ryan was never on board with it from the beginning. There's now a louder cry for them to rescind the invite. I don't know if that's going to happen, but that's currently where we are with it. What my article said that Brother Richard was referring to earlier is, I was the first journalist in NABJ to ask for the president, Ken Lemon's resignation. I just feel like you cannot be that out of touch in something this important at the biggest event your organization runs, and you be so disrespectful to your host chapter, let alone the overall membership, but that you didn't even inform the chapter president of Chicago about this so that he could inform us, that we found out at the same time as everybody else in the world found out. Yeah, that's not going to fly. And we've now learned today from the president of NABJ that he had been talking to the Trump and Harris campaign for weeks to try to get them to appear here. So this wasn't just some spur of the moment thing that they did, which is why they announced it. They had been trying to get him for a long time, and they never told the membership, hey, we send out invites to both candidates, or we're really trying to bring candidate Trump in. And so what they've done, Brother BJ, is they've tried to say, well, we've always extended these invites to both candidates, which is absolutely 100% true. However, you also have to understand that Donald Trump isn't really a candidate right now. We know what he is. He's a devil. And the first rule of dealing with the devil is don't.
That's right. Yeah.
That's the first rule. So he's not a candidate. He's a person that's trying to send us back to slavery.
So Brother Jason, I was telling Brother Naba'a and Brother James D. that I know Ken Lemon personally because he's from Charlotte, and he's been a reporter on the number one TV station back there, the ABC affiliate, WSOC. And I actually texted him when we began the show to see if we can get him on, but I would like to give
Ken Lemon the benefit of the doubt about his intent to question Trump in front of black journalists, right? But the fact that he did not tell, he didn't tell anybody in Chicago about his intent, and he kind of left everybody in the dark. It makes him look like a shady Negro. You know what I'm saying? And you know, he's a peculiar dude, man. He's a peculiar guy. But I would like to say, I hope he didn't make Charlotte Brothers look bad by we find out something about him that we didn't know. But I don't like the fact that he left everybody in the dark. That's what makes this more.
Yeah.
Go ahead, bro.
No, I'm sorry. Go ahead. No.
I just said that's what makes this a little bit more, you know, like, it's very peculiar. Yeah. You know, he didn't include everybody on the decision. I mean, why not be transparent?
That's what I was wondering. What was the, was it just his decision alone? He obviously conferred with some folks, and there's, I would imagine there's a process with regard to doing something like that that involves more than just the president. So if that was the case, of course, why wasn't obviously the local chapter notified? There's got to be something like, in my mind, something deep in there that you're getting ready to do this big thing and you're not notifying the Chicago chapter. So is it something about Chicago chapter that you had an issue with as the body who was organizing this interview? So there's something to it. And of course, the Butler Lemon, you know, he should have overruled and made sure that Chicago was notified. But
I think it was his decision. He the one that did the rules. The president. It wasn't nobody else. Yeah, and the other thing is, not only did he not—I mean, you know, Brother James, that you know there's a basic thing. If you're the leader of NABJ, and if you don't know, you need to have a look. The sister who was the co-chair was not impressed, so she didn't quit as the co-chair. She like the hell with this. I'm out of here as the co-chair of the convention. If you're the president of NABJ and you don't know that if you bringing Donald Trump to NABJ, that need to be fully vetted. You ain't got no business being
that's
president.
The point. But I'm saying that
you ain't got no business being president.
And a bunch of other folks. I don't know what the process of NABJ is, but that's what I'm saying.
Sure.
How you going to do it without notifying? And what is it about? What's deep inside you all's thinking that make you think that you're going to do it without notifying somebody, and that nothing is not going to be a repercussion behind it?
Right.
And I think that's what we're getting to now, Brother James. I spoke with Karen Atia, who was the co-chair of the convention, who resigned, and she told me, Jason, I had no clue any of this was going on. I was completely in the dark. She said, I found out what you all found out. Now, she's the co-chair of the whole conference.
Wow.
And she wasn't informed by this. She found out Donald Trump was coming at the same time as everybody else did. That's telling me this was a very closed group of individuals who made this decision. And we're trying our best right now. You know, the thing about this, which I think is hilarious, is that this is a organization of journalists, and they don't think journalists are going to get to the truth. that's got to be the most ironic part.
That's got to be kind of ridiculous.
Exactly. I think this was a decision made probably 4 or 5 people max, because it was so quietly kept. That's how I know it was a very small group. Because it's hard to keep a secret, especially one like you bringing Donald Trump to Chicago to speak to thousands of black journalists. And you know his history with Chicago, and you know how our community feels about Donald Trump. They kept this between at least 5 people. I swear I don't think it was any more than 5 people. Because if the co-chair doesn't even know what's going on, that's telling me a lot. Now, in terms of what you said about Brother Lemons, BJ, and yes, I appreciate that you know him and everything, but here's my thing. If I'm getting all that backlash that he's been getting over the last 24 hours, and I have a friend, right, like, reach out to me, and I know you have a show in Chicago at a black radio station, yeah, man, when can I come on? I can give you, like, 5 or 10 minutes. I can give you some time to talk about what went into the decision-making process and who all I talked to and how we went about that. He has not done that at all. That's what the membership is upset about.
Yeah.
That's what's telling us this isn't on the up and up. And then there are a couple other problems with this in that the three journalists who were selected, one is the... I don't like to call her journalist because I think she's an agent of misinformation from Fox News. Paris Faulkner. Paris Faulkner. I don't consider her a journalist. I consider her an enemy of our people, if anything.
Right.
And then they have a sister from ABC News who's a correspondent. What we've also learned out is that, right, Rachel Scott. And what we now understand is that she was selected by NABJ. And that the other two journalists were selected by Trump's people on this panel. And
wait the hell a minute. No.
That's how that went down. And so if you listen to Lemon's statement. This was a selection process by the Trump campaign. That's all we've heard so far. And, you know, we are really digging into this. And we're really coming up. There are a lot of journalists who are working on this behind the scenes. And I think by the time they leave Chicago, we're going to finally figure out what happened here. But there's no way. There should not have been more vetting of who was even on the panel, what the selection process was. Make that, you know, transparent, so everybody in the organization understands, well, these are the people, even if you're going to bring them, which is a bad decision, but if you're going to bring them, this is who we think should interview them. These people have shown that they can handle this type of interview, blah, 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 blah. They never did that. And one other young lady is a person none of us know, and she's worked at a publication that was only created like 2 years ago.
Yeah.
And so that's also given us a bunch of alarms on how is this going down? How is it nobody from Chicago is on that panel to interview them in our city after all the stuff he's talked about our city?
Hold on. Man, I wish we had more time. Can we go ahead and open it up? Can we run another half hour or something? We need to go on Twitter or something and continue this. I don't want to give this up. I really don't.
There's a lot to this. And I think, you know, this first 24 hours, you're dealing with a lot of anger, a lot of shock. But now that part is starting to wear off. So now people are starting to use their anger and energy in a more positive way, and they're like, you know, we're going to find out what happened here. And especially the people who spend hundreds of thousands of dollars to come from out of town, get hotel rooms, all this, and, you know, they didn't know about Donald Trump. So here's the third part of it, gentlemen, that because you kind of put the city of Chicago under the bus, too, because the mayor didn't really know he was coming, which means they've now got to pull police resources. It's probably coming out of our community. Let's keep it real. They got to pull out police resources to provide security for downtown, not just because he's coming, but he had a recent assassination attempt.
Yeah.
Cult members are going to come. There are already protesters from our community who said they're coming out in force. And tomorrow is going to be almost 95 degrees. Now, you put that whole mix in together, and you bring all these people together in this one small spot, there's a potential for some serious problems here tomorrow. And that's my problem with the NABJ president, is that you now put our members in this just perfect storm of emotions and for something to jump off. And you've got our members out here. You got a lot of our single female members who came out here by themselves, who don't know Chicago. Yeah. What are they going to do if something jumps off? You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And so that's the third aspect of this.
I'm going to tell you something, too, about NABJ in the Charlotte chapter, and he's the, you know, the head of that chapter. And I don't find the subjects and the events that they have, they don't have no teeth to it. You know what I'm saying? It's not like a pro-black journalistic stance.
Yeah.
And I've always noticed that with him at the leadership of the NABJ for Charlotte chapter. And I can say that, you know, publicly and, you know, and stand on that if I was talking to him personally, but I've never seen that kind of a pro-black stance. He's kind of stay away from that. He's very generic, very safe type dude in Charlotte.
I got two quick questions. Number one, I don't know, I haven't looked at Ken's journalistic background, but, and maybe Nava, you could tell me, but is there something about journalistic standards and ethics that kind of make you question how you bring a person to be interviewed and a political candidate to be interviewed, and that candidate chooses the journalist that's going to question him? That's one.
Well,
Let me get the second question. The second question is, since they disinvited the minister from the 1993 March on Washington, can they disinvite Trump at this hour? From coming to this convention? But the standards piece, I'm wondering, is this cat is a real, I don't know him, this gentleman is a real, what kind of journalism he practices, you know?
Well, this is the thing, right? he tweeted out, according to a media report, that this is not absolutely not an endorsement of Trump. And he said, every year, every presidential election, we invited the presidential candidates to come. We invited both of them. We got a yes from one of them. He's up to get a yes from Kamala. This is an opportunity for us to vet the candidates on our ground. See, to me, and that's him. Then you got Tia Mitchell, who's quoted as saying she's a Washington correspondent for the Atlanta Journal-Constitution, and her post on X responded to the controversy over Trump's appearance, saying she helped arrange the event as a chair member of NABJ's political task force. Quote, I helped make this call, and it's in line with invitations NABJ has sent to every presidential candidate for decades, wrote Mitchell in that X feed. But continue to go off on your feed. I'll continue to work to create opportunities for journalists to interview the next potential president. Let me say this, man. It's amazing to me what the Negro mind can contort itself to do to justify interacting with white folks.
Right.
Trump has already made his positions known. He don't need to be vetted.
Right.
What is he going to tell you at this convention that he ain't already told you?
Right.
And in addition to that, this man has attacked black female journalists in addition to the stuff about Chicago.
Right.
What are you going to learn from him? Nothing. And then the fact that April Ryan, who I happen to have gone to school with at Morgan State, shout out to MSU, you know, this sister had to get security, private security, because she worked at the White House, and this man targeted her. You know, the other sister, Jamel Hill, similar. So this is not a man who just has some extreme views or different views, man. So you're bringing him for what? You're bringing him and you're talking about, we've done these invitations for years. Yeah, but this is a different guy. This is a totally different situation. And if you were above board, but James, you and I and all four of us on this call know, you don't announce something at 9 o'clock at night if you want people to know it.
That's right.
The night before.
Right.
So to me, it's like this false sense of journalistic ethics, man. Standing on the truth in the interest of black people.
But look, man, to me, it's like, why would Trump, knowing his record with the black community and his the words that he has spoken, why would he even want to come or come, feel comfortable in coming? Because really, he should be feeling like he's walking into the hornet's nest.
Yeah.
And that, hey, and that, hey, you know, and that this is not going to be a great experience. So what is it, other than the fact that he has already chosen, he chose the question, the people on the panel, well, how do you feel so comfortable walking into the hornet's nest? I'm trying to figure that part out.
I think I can answer that part. He wants the conflict. He wants to be on camera arguing with the Negroes. That's good for him.
Right.
That don't hurt him. Go ahead, Jason.
I think the other part of that is that he feels a level of comfort because Harrison Faulkner is going to be there and is going to be the main moderator.
Yeah, he chose him, right.
And if that's one of his picks, if you got two of the three, let's say this was a trial. If you got two of the people in the jury that you already paid off, let's go to court. You'll be very confident. That's why he's so confident and arrogant. And I think the other thing, if you study what Trump has done throughout his history, is he's always used black people or platforms to boost himself before he disregards them. What he did with Omarosa. What he did with, what's the young lady from the actress, Stacey Dash. What he did with Kanye West.
Yeah.
This is his M.O. This is his M.O. He's just now been able to leverage an entire organization this time, which is why I, again, say that I believe in leadership, we need to just clean house. Because I think some people in that organization have been compromised in some way. To allow this to happen, and because it's been too quiet, and they're not being transparent about how this whole thing came about. Again, Brother BJ reached out to his brother from Charlotte. He didn't even hit you back.
Right, right. And you know, another thing,
you see what I'm saying?
Jason, and let's go to the people that was in that inner circle who knew the decision had been made, and they didn't say nothing.
Right.
What were they afraid of?
Only one other person. Only one other person has come out, Brother Richard said, that's the sister Tia, who works for the Atlanta Journal of Constitution. She's the only person who came out and said, but she did it very early after the announcements, maybe a few minutes later when the backlash started, and she gave a very flippant response, which is why she got dragged the way she did on social media. It was because of the way she came out about it. Now, since she's now gone quiet, she's gone dark.
Yeah. Oh, she's gone dark.
She's gone dark now. But now we know this is more than just two people who was involved in this. But now nobody wants to say nothing. That's telling me they knew what they were doing is wrong.
So Ken Lemon is gone. I mean, there's no possible way that he can remain the president. What do you think?
You would think, but I don't know, because I'm not hearing from other members of the board. I'm not hearing from other NABJ officers who are saying, well, you know, I was the voice of reason telling them not to do it. You know, I don't know. But I imagine in that election, there's no way in the world he's going to win.
Yeah.
Yeah, but I'm telling you, Trump can't lose, man. He wants, and you know you have a couple Negroes in the audience saying Negroes for Trump. Yep. He's going to get that picture, and he's going to get the picture standing up to black people. They ain't voting for him anyway. He wants the conflict. He wants the picture of the great white hunter in the jungle dealing with the natives. And he's not going to be dealing with men, which is not to say that women can't be strong. He ain't going to be dealing with a man that when he get to talking, beating his chest, the man gonna get the beat in his too. Like, motherfucker, who you talking to?
Right.
Who you talking to? You must not know where you at, cracker. He ain't gonna get that. He might get it though, but these sisters, I mean, I don't know him, but certainly he ain't gonna get it from Faulkner. I doubt if he get it from the sister from ABC. Is she ABC?
Yep, she's ABC right now.
Yeah, she ain't getting it.
She can't go off because she got to keep her professional demeanor.
Right.
the other sisters in a group that's only 2 years old. So where's even the longevity and knowing anything about politics and candidates coming to NABJ?
Exactly.
The history of that and how this is so different.
Exactly. So, you know, I think, you know, again, what I've been telling my Chicago people is that, you know, he's coming. We know he's going to bring his co-followers. People are going to be down there protesting. Might be a good idea to avoid downtown Chicago tomorrow, because also what else is going on down there, fellas? The Lollapalooza Music Festival.
Oh, Lord have mercy.
Yeah.
Exactly. So we got the Lollapalooza people in town, and Lollapalooza is directly across the street from the hotel from the Hilton.
Yeah, he calculated.
So you got all these elements, these elements coming together in one small, confined area?
Yeah.
Man. You know, I was reading another piece by this brother, John W. Fountain, that he published on Substack. His column is 50 Cent a Word. But he weighs in on this, man, and he weighed in, which I thought he made some great points. Roland Martin weighed in. I thought he gave some good points. But John Fountain kind of rolls through all of this stuff, and he just, you know, lists this man. He lists that he lists that. You know, he asked the question, indeed, at the convention's opening on Wednesday at high noon, Trump is scheduled to appear before a black journalist on the Q&A with hand-picked interviewers. He didn't say by who. That's interesting. Maybe he didn't know. Rachel Scott, senior congressional correspondent for ABC News. So she's not even like a White House correspondent. She's Congress. First, Faulkner, anchor, Faulkner Focus and host, co-host about numbers on Fox News, and Tadia Goba, politics reporter at Senator. Then he asked, no shade, but who?
Yeah.
You want to have a political discussion. Seriously, where are the political heavyweights here, man?
Right.
You got somebody that is a senior congressional correspondent. She's not covering the White House. Is she the congressional correspondent? Is she covering the national presidential election anyway? So even that, when you get the specialties, man, you know, and how black can any of these people be on this panel? Or they got a journalist person, not black? Is that what it is? Or since I guess Kamala Harris didn't confirm, were they trying to show her their quote-unquote independence from her and send a signal on this?
Well, we have new information on that as well tonight, fellas.
According
to April Ryan and a number of other journalists, they have confirmed that the Harris camp did reach out to NABJ and said that while she cannot appear in person because she's got some scheduling stuff, she's speaking at Congressman Lee's funeral down in Texas, and she's also speaking at one of the black sororities, their big convention down there. She can't do it these next 2 days, but she wanted to do something maybe virtually, like a sit-down live interview virtually, and NABJ said no.
That's crazy.
And that's a report that's coming from April Ryan.
Go ahead. See this, man. This is where you get into Negro journalists. See, you got to get that daggone white-minded journalism out your damn head, man. It'll mess you up every time. But maybe that'll help you keep a job with white folks. And maybe that's what you're more concerned about. The mission of NABJ, it is to help protect the interests of black journalists and our community. Or am I wrong, Jason? Am I off?
You are 100% correct, which is why you never seen my byline in any of them other type publications.
I mean, so you know, it's but in your mind as a Negro, trained by white folks. Look, Jake Tapper represents Jewish people all day long on CNN. All day. And it comes out in his coverage. It comes out in how he tells his stories. It comes out mm-hmm. in how he chooses his sources. And it comes out in how he editorializes during his program. He don't apologize for that. Never. And the white ones certainly don't apologize for their whiteness. Only the Negro got to apologize. And sometimes in that mindset, you're setting up this thing. Look, man, I get the rule, kind of the rule, because I think they had it. Was it with Barack Obama that he had to show up to the convention or they wasn't going to interview him, or was that something else?
Yeah. They've done that before in the past with people.
Yeah. So I get the rule. But with Kamala Harris being recently appointed, I mean recently becoming the presumed Democratic Party nominee, with the death of our sister Sheila Jackson Lee, strong champion for our people, and you can read a cover story about her in this week's final call out of Houston, already having booked a speech at one of the sororities. I wonder which one it is. And maybe
I think it's the Rose, if I'm not mistaken. I think it's the Rose.
Gamma Row. Okay, yeah.
Yep, Sigma Gamma Row. Yep.
Yeah, so with so much, I could see why. It ain't like she's been a nominee the whole time. She mm-hmm. had, what, a couple weeks of this? So mm-hmm. I think it would make, if I was NABJ, what I would have negotiated was this. I would have negotiated, she does a virtual, but then she got to do something else with us real soon. Strictly NABJ members, right?
Mm-hmm.
So you get mm-hmm. two shots at her. So you get her now, maybe before she does her vice presidential pick, and then you get something exclusive to NABJ after she makes her, after she chooses her vice presidential candidate, and she, maybe she breaks that in the NABJ interviews, right?
Mm-hmm.
So that you give her something, but to me it makes sense based on that. Now, I don't know if I should say this, but I talked to somebody earlier and they said they thought somebody got paid off. I'm not going to say who said that to me, because I'm not going to say who said that. But when you operate like this, it wasn't, what was it, who?
Yeah, I just, Jason didn't get paid off, man.
No, he didn't. Hey, bro, James, trust me. He definitely did not.
He did not.
He did not get paid off. I'm not saying that he said somebody else did. I'm just saying he definitely is off the payoff list.
Yeah, I know that.
That's right.
But when you operate like this, man, you open up, you know.
Yeah.
You open the door for this, man.
Yeah.
You know, the other thing, Jason, is that, which I think people have to understand, this NABJ convention, man, it's really like a homecoming. It's a family thing. It's where the black journalists that work for white people can commiserate about their horrible bosses, and they can try to get jobs. It's like we all together, though. You know what I mean? I mean, and I don't mean that
that's
in
funny.
A negative way.
No, that's funny.
Like the brothers got a basketball tournament. They go running. I mean, they, you know, it's like, I mean, it is family. You know what I mean? It's so now, and people bring their children. It's a special time for people that often feel unappreciated and besieged within the very fields that they work in.
Right.
Many of them do not feel welcome at all.
Yeah.
So it's a relief to be in a place where they can be accepted and be themselves. You know what I mean? So they bring their wives, they bring their children. Now, all of that's like kind of being disrupted.
I mean, would you want Trump? Why would Trump is stealing the damn show? Instead of talking about him being ABJ, what are we talking about? Trump?
Right.
Right.
Right. Which I think is really the worst part. Because there's so many other panels that are also taking place at the same time. But it was wild because one of the brothers was like, well, man, I guess now nobody's coming to my panel. You know, y'all gave me the same time as him. And now you release this information at the last minute. I had some people confirmed to come to mine. Now they don't even want to come to the top at all while he's there.
Right. That's right.
You know, they don't even want to be in the building now because of a lot of things we talked about, the security concerns, the protester concerns, the cult followers that are going to show up, CPD showing up. You know, they got a history with us. This was poorly planned and rolled out, and I have serious questions about this. I was the first NABJ journalist to come out and ask for the president's resignation, but plenty more people are now doing it as well. So I don't know if he will still be the president by the end of this conference. There is a board meeting coming up on Saturday, an NABJ board meeting. So now what they're doing, we're encouraging all of our members to attend the board meeting. So usually at these conferences, you know, the board meeting, people have usually been out kicking it the night before, Brother James. They ain't in no condition to come to no board meeting. But because of everything that's gone down this time, I think this board meeting that they do on Saturday, if they can make it there, is going to be one of the most raucous, chaotic board meetings in the history of NABJ. Because there are members who are extremely upset and we're not getting answers, and the leadership at NABJ has stuck their heads in the sand and are not responding to anything, thinking that this is just going to blow over, and it's not.
Yeah. Wow.
Yeah. So, and what happens going forward for the organization? To me, this certainly doesn't strengthen it. I mean, it really doesn't, you know. But what are you feeling about, you know, what does this mean? Because certainly Chicago, I'm assuming if that president and that administration for NABJ don't go, they ain't getting nothing out of Chicago.
Well, what I'll say is that the Philadelphia branch has already broken off from the main branch, and they did it 2 years ago. I spoke with their president earlier today, a cool brother named Ernest Owens. He actually was born in Chicago and was raised somewhere else, so we had that little connection. And he told me a little bit about his story and why he broke off from them. And he had a lot of questions about leadership, and he was publicly challenging the leadership as the president of the Philadelphia office. They didn't like that. They kind of banned him. They kind of ostracized him. So his group was powerful enough. They said, you know what, we'll do a job. We'll be our own little branch. So they're not even affiliated with NABJ anymore, the Philadelphia group. I can see more of that happening with these chapters breaking off and splintering off. I can definitely see the membership taking a huge dip. I pretty much made the decision I'm not renewing because, like I say, I've been kind of hit or miss with them anyway. But after this experience, you know, I'm pretty much done with it. But the key, I think, is that the younger journalists, you know, we know every revolution starts with the younger generation. And if you lose them, you don't have nothing. It's like if you got a church and everybody in the church, the average age is 75, your church ain't going to be around much longer.
Right.
You got to have them young people. And if they leave, you're in trouble.
Well, Jason, let me ask y'all this, because to me, I've never seen the NABJ act as a revolutionary journalistic organization, but has it ever performed like that at one time?
Yeah, I think with the original members when NABJ started, you know, we got to think about that era. It was Jim Crow era, you know, and it's like every other aspect of black society and culture. When we weren't allowed to be a part of other groups, we had to stick together. We had to be revolutionary. And then, you know, as time as we start getting more gains, more rights, you know, we can compromise this, we can compromise that. So, yes, I agree with you. I think probably in the early years, it definitely was. Where it is now, I think it's more, and this is something we would talk about within an organization, they cater too much on the clout-heavy top people who work at these huge TV stations with four letters.
There you go.
Letters.
Yeah. Right.
And you're forgetting that the bulk of your organization is your foot soldiers. It's the people who work for the Final Call. It's the people who work for Crusader, the people who work for Citizen, the people that work for all the small black newspapers who are in the trenches, who live in the neighborhood that they cover. If you're a TV journalist making $3 million a year as an anchor, you ain't living in the hood.
You ain't living in the hood.
But if you're working for one of these smaller publications and you're there embedded with the community and you too hear gunshots at night when them fools are shooting up the block, okay, those are the people you got to listen to because they're your frontline soldiers. They're the people who are getting you the information firsthand. And when you don't listen to them and you do moves like NABJ has been doing, you're eventually going to kill off your own organization. And I think this is going to be a serious blow to NABJ, especially with NNPA coming out and announcing that they want NABJ to rescind the invitation. And in addition to that, NNPA tonight also announced they are endorsing Kamala Harris for president. And they said this is the first time in the history of the NNPA, which has got to be at least 85 years old, brother James, NNPA?
Yeah.
It's got to be.
Okay.
Yeah, something like that. They said this is the first time in the history of their organization they've ever endorsed a presidential candidate. So if NNPA is going completely the opposite of NABJ, and NNPA has always been more revolutionary, but what I think is going to happen is that you're going to actually see another organization come from this. Because I think neither one of those organizations do a good job of catering to digital media, which is where a lot of the young journalists are now. They're in the strictly digital platforms. And I think there needs to be an organization specifically dedicated to them. And I think probably within the next couple of years, you're going to see something come together that'll be, so then we'll have, you know, considered, I guess, three organizations, which I'm fine with. I think we need options. But I think in the present time, NABJ has to do some soul searching. They got to understand their mission. I'm sure ancestors Evelyn Payne and Ida B. Wells are rolling over their graves with what has taken place. And the fact that it's taking place here in Chicago, it's not good. It's not good. And I'm really frustrated that they did not use the Chicago chapter because we do have resources. We have people who could have done a lot of these interviews who are more qualified than at least two of the people who are up there. I'm going to say that. Right. I don't think two of them are even qualified to do this. But, you know, it is what it is at this point. And I just think the next 24 to 48 hours it will be extremely telling. So I encourage the community as a whole to keep an eye on.
All right. Well, Jason, stay in touch, man. And
Man,
keep my number handy in case you need to give me some more info, because I'm telling you, I tell you, man, the thing that I think about is when you got to ask, am I black first, or am I journalist first?
Wow.
That's the problem.
Yeah.
Because white folks don't ask, am I white first, or am I a journalist? They don't ask, am I an American first? Or am I a journalist? You know, our role is to balance the scales, to correct that which is incorrect, to make smooth that which is crooked, man. But anyway, keep loving on white folks. Go Trump.
Well, Brother Jason, thank you, man. You sound like you'd be a great leader of an organization, man. I hope you get to be the president of the NABJ or something. You ought to run for it.
Hey, he's the head of the dude to wear the crown, BJ.
Jason, wait. Give us your website and how we can follow you. That's the other thing.
Sure. You can follow me on Twitter. My Twitter handle is @JayCoyden, Coyden. But for my website is JayCoyden, Coyden. Reports. So the letter J, Coyden Reports, NABJ.com, and I, you know, have started my own website. I started like 3 years ago, but I still freelance. You know, like Brother Richard knows, I still reach out to him sometimes with stories. But that's my website, and it's my way of you know, breaking into this market as well, because I think we need a lot more voices and people who can get information in different ways out there.
Hey, Jason,
and,
we need to
try to focus on our stuff.
We need to talk a little bit about maybe you want to write something for StraightWords.
Yeah, you know I'm always available. Yeah, without a doubt.
Let's maybe an analytical piece so you can say what you want. Okay.
All right, no problem. I appreciate it.
Thank you,
Brother
Jason. Thank you for coming on, man.
All right. All right, you all be safe and have a good night. All right.
You too,
man. Bye-bye.
Wow, man.
All right.
Okay.
Yeah,
hey, man.
We can't go on over there.
No,
damn.
Man.
Yeah, we good.
He's going to be leaving the studio. I don't know if he want to hang around, man.
Oh, that's right. Yeah, Deontay got to get out of there. We can't hold him hostage.
No.
Our great producer, Deontay, in Chicago, WVON Studios, and, of course, our sister, Jeanette. Wonderful job putting this program together tonight, brother. This is one of the books right here. Y'all got to go back and check out the replay of the whole show on our website, straightwords.com. We'll have the replay up for you by the time you wake up in the morning. Brother Richard works all night getting this content. Now, we, brothers and sisters, we serious about this. Ain't playing. That's why you need to support us.
Yeah,
straightwords.com, straightwords.com, and give us a donation. We are pleading with you to help us keep this program on the air so we can keep giving you content and straight words just like we're doing. All right, so straightwords.com. Text us tonight before you go to bed, 312-480-9775, 312-480-9775. All right, we're going to wrap it up, brothers and sisters, but don't forget, God want us to be together in unity and love. So every time you see a black face come in front of you today, show your love. It don't cost you nothing to show your love to your people. Come on, y'all. We'll see you next Tuesday. Be at the will of Almighty God, Allah, right here on WVON 1690, the Talk of Chicago, Straight Words. Assalamu alaikum.
Waalaikumsalam. Go Trump.
And yeah, let's start thinking what we're doing. I don't let nothing change your mind. Let's start heading homeward bound.
The Talk of Chicago and the voice of the nation is 1690 WVON, Berwyn, Chicago.